Good evening to all the participants. I welcome all of you to this program on Python, again a uniquely designed program by our colleague coordinator Shweta Jain and the team WIRC. So I also recognize presence of WIRC chairman Sri Lalit Bajaj. He is with us. And we also have the learned faculty Rahul, who is going to be with us for the whole series, the session, and he will talk us through in detail. And of course, I recognize presence and welcome Shweta, and also thank her for coordinating the whole event.
Thank you for giving me this opportunity, Chairman, you both and WIRC.
Thank you, madam. Thank you for all the efforts. Like because we all you come ahead and help us, we are able to do so many good programs. And in line with what the chairman had planned, that we should enable our members technologically, there are multiple programs which have happened, starting from Excel to Tally to artificial intelligence to X and Y data analytics, and now this Python coding. So there are these multiple things which we are planning, and also we are tied up with a lot of organization for various tools which can be used by small and medium practitioners. And at least four of those tie-ups we included in this month's newsletter, and I'm sure all the participants would have seen through that. So with that, I think I welcome all and thank you for joining in, and happy learning. And I now request the WIRC chairman CL Lalit Bajaj for his opening remarks. Lalit bhai, over to you.
Yeah, thanks Murtuja bhai. Sorry, I'm not visible. I will be on audio today. Mr. Rahul Tiwari, faculty for this particular subject, my co-colleague Murtuja Kachwala, coordinator Shweta Jain, and all the participants, on behalf of WIRC, I welcome all of you in this August gathering, wherein we are supposed to discuss the medium of Python for data analysis and business analytics. Friends, let me share with all of you that we have engaged in multiple workshops and seminars as far as data analysis and visualization and business analysis is concerned. As a concept, data analysis is describing past trends, understanding current trends, evaluating future trends. And when we talk about business analytics, whether predictive or prescriptive analysis, it helps us anticipating what, when, and why outcomes will happen. And friends, as a consultant, we have a bigger role as to the outcome of data analysis and the understanding of data analysis. How can we be best put to use as far as decision-taking process in any organization is concerned? So I think so this is the workshop wherein we are really going to understand as far as the outcome of data analysis and how can it be taken ahead with business decision making. Python is quickly becoming go-to language of machine learning and is used to create models for Bayesian networks, decision trees, and much more. Friends, let me tell you that it is a medium which is very effective in terms of cost and time efforts. So I look forward for a better version of all of us post this workshop, because I think so somewhere or the other, we have been coming out with a thought process of equipping ourselves on software learning side and technology side. I think so, and this is one further step on this. And Rahul Tiwari being on the board on the subject, I believe that he will ensure that we get best of the knowledge and information on the subject to the extent possible. just a thing to share with all of you that as Murtuza bhai has already mentioned, do take benefit of the software service providers which we have engaged into. We are planning to take couple of initiatives as far as the activity of data analysis, business analytics is concerned. And let me tell all of you that we are trying to become more originative and become more interactive as far as various all these initiatives are concerned. I would request all the members that we are in the process of forming a small group to take ahead with all these initiatives. Those all who are interested to participate in this initiative, please write to us at wirc@ici.in. One more thing, this is something which has not been happening at WIRC much. So at times it may happen that we might be missing some of the other link as far as this particular area of learning and education is concerned. I would really look upon to all of you as far as enlightenment and on various scope of enrichment on this subject, because your suggestions will really help us to come out with more such activities. So I look forward with some more suggestions from all of you so that we can plan more such kind of events and initiate more such kind of initiatives for the help of all. With this, I once again welcome all of you and look forward for a very engaging workshop in these 5 days. I believe that there will be lot many doubts and lot many queries in this particular workshop. And let me ensure you that whatever doubts, whatever query comes to your mind, our coordinator will ensure that it reaches to the board. And I will request Rahul Tiwari ji to ensure that he replies to all the queries which are raised by all our members. With this, I thank once again all of you for participating. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman, for your opening remarks and touching upon the important subject and practical aspects around it. So friends, it is about getting the data from the production environment into a test environment or a data warehouse or whatever, understanding what is the master, what is the table, what is the data, writing the queries, and then trying to see what exactly the business needs. And it is like beyond taxation or audit. You're going to work with the sales team, the marketing team, the finance team, the operations team. And like Rahul has talked about, he's got experience in dealing with the retail and the telecom and X and Y. And Rahul is also an expert on the viewing solutions. And like when the data comes, you need to present them in proper format, the graphs, the table, the charts. And there are front viewing softwares like Tableau, etc., also on which Rahul is an expert. But let me take this also opportunity to introduce Rahul. Rahul trains and consults organization and individual on business analytics, data science, and machine language. For 14 years plus, he has been helping students and organization in various domains like retail, telecom, life sciences, finance, in solving the business problems using data science, business analytics, and machine language. He is certified Tableau and Teradata associate and also MBA in business analytics and data science. So welcome, Rahul. And with that, I present Rahul before you. Rahul, over to you.
Hello guys, so welcome all of you. I hope this entire 1 week will be interesting for all of you guys. You will learn something new. Today we'll start with the basics. We'll definitely not get much into the detail, but I will get an idea about how this particular programming language is. What is the future of this? Obviously, I'll not get into much technical because we are not from that technical background, but yes, I'll try to make it things more simple for you guys so that at the end, once you complete this program, you should have at least some of the confidence to solve some of your day-to-day work. Maybe if you want to do some calculations, then you can very well create the functions using Python, and then you can use that for your day-to-day work. You use Python and solve all your problems using Python, right? So we'll try to make at that level. So why Python suddenly coming in demand? The only reason is that it's an open source programming language. I don't have to pay any money for that. and it's again can be used for various skill sets, or I can say various things can be done using Python. That is, if I want to create a desktop application, I can do that. If I want to create a website using Python, that is also pretty much possible. If I want to create any do any automation, that can be done as well. I can do using Python. If I want to do data analytics, data science, machine learning, artificial intelligence, like ask for anything, you will find that. So that is the main benefit of this particular program. I'm hoping that all of you guys have installed Python in your machine. So I gave the link to the team, and from that you can install Python. So if it's not done yet, I'll just quickly talk about it. So here we have anaconda.com, which you can use. In this anaconda.com, you can go to the product and individual edition. I'm going with Anaconda. The reason is that it's a platform which is highly used for data analytics. In any of the IT companies, you can see that people are using it a lot for data science. You can from the very start page, you can see that, right? Data science technology for competitive edge and so on. So this is like one of the I can say highly demanding platform which people are using in their day-to-day work. That's why I gave you this name to install Python in your machine. You can install Python from Python website also. That is also pretty much possible. So you can go to Python and you can go to downloads and download the version of Python. But yeah, Anaconda is the one which I think you will use a lot in your day-to-day work if you are comfortable with Python. So that's why I asked you to do that. Go to the down. You can see that we have different machines, Windows, Mac OS, and Linux. Based on that, you can able to download whatever machine you have in your with you, right? So that is 64-bit or 32-bit, you can download that. Why I'm asking you to download this? The reason is that some of the data science packages, like in future you think that you want to get into data science and use data science in your day-to-day work. So in that case, these are some of the packages which by default comes with Python in Anaconda. So if you download Python from Python website, then these packages, which are like SkyPy, NumPy, scikit-learn, pandas, these packages will not come with the Anaconda version, with the Python version. So you require to go with Anaconda. Else, if you are installing through Python, then you have to manually install those packages. So better to go with Anaconda and download Python from here. Right, so I think I hope all of you guys have downloaded this. Once it is downloaded, then you can go very well and look for Jupyter. So this is my Jupyter notebook. So this is the place where we will actually do the coding. Right, we can do coding using Jupyter. There are other GUIs as well, which is like user interface where we can do coding, but people are using Jupyter notebook more as compared to other user interfaces. The reason is that it is a web-based solution, and that actually makes things more flexible and I can say more scalable, because I can integrate my Jupyter notebook with the websites as well. For example, you have your own website and you want to integrate Python with your website, so using Jupyter notebook you can very well do that. So which will help us to give a flexibility to do the coding on Jupyter anywhere. Like suppose you are driving or you are in a car and sitting at the backside and want to do some coding, you can very well do that with Jupyter because it is a web-based solution. So in this entire program, we are going to use Jupyter notebook, and this is the page you will see basically once you launch the Jupyter notebook. Here you can see it is a page which you are getting in. You can click on this new and you can click on this Python. And once you click on the Python 3, you will get this particular page, which is like this, where we actually do the coding. This is the place we will start doing the coding. The name Jupyter comes in because there are three programming languages. One is Julia, second is Python, and the third is R programming. So all the three programming can be run using Jupyter. That's why they have given the name as Jupyter. Now, I will start with the basic understanding of I'll just first of all show you that how simple this programming language is. This is basically, people say it's like an English programming language. We just have to write some English words and we are done with it. And that is the fact. We don't have to write a very tough type of syntax and all. I'll just show you. I'll do one small coding and I'll not explain that as of now because we are not at that level. But yeah, I'll quickly show you that if I want to create a 6-digit OTP number, if I want to generate a 6-digit OTP number, how many lines of code is required? Maybe you will think I will require 10 lines, 15 lines of code to generate a 6-digit OTP numbers. But in Python, we require only 3 lines of code, which will help me to generate 6-digit OTP numbers, right? I'll quickly create one code and I'll help you understand that. This particular exercise is just to help you understand that how powerful this particular language is and how a non-technical person can also learn this programming language. So here I'll write a code. Right. Now here you can see from random is one of the packages, so which I'm calling. So Python is a package driven programming language. So we basically call the package for our own tasks. If I want to do some mathematical calculation, then I can call my package called NumPy, which will help me do some mathematics, right? If I want to do any mathematics. If I want to do some machine learning, if I want to do some data science problem, then the relevant packages are already available. So we just have to call that package and that package will solve the problem. So here also, I am calling one module or a package called random, which is helping me to basically generate a random number. And we want to create a random number. Right? So for I in range 0, 10, so basically this range function we'll see in the future class. As of now, it just, as I mentioned, this is just to help you understand the power of this programming language. Print randint. Randint will generate a random integer. I want to generate a random integer between 0 to 9, and this I want to generate 6 times because I want 6-digit OTP number. And you can see that I have created a code which is helping me to generate 6-digit OTP number. So how many lines it took? It took around 3 lines to complete this code. And as of now, it is generating 10 OTP numbers. We can generate like infinite OTP numbers with just 3 lines. I will increase this 0 to 10. I will make it 0 to 100. It will generate 100 OTP numbers. Right, so I just have to change this number and automatically it will give me the that number of OTP numbers. Okay, but you can see that the main thing is how simple it is. Obviously, we don't know what form is, what for is, what import is, what range is, what rand and int is. We are not sure what it is. But you can see that by seeing this, I don't feel that it is very much difficult for me to understand if I know the basics of Python. So that is the main benefit which we have in this particular programming language. Now, let's start with the identifiers. Now, what are identifiers? Basically, I want to create some variable. For example, let's say I want to store the interest rate of my bank loan. So that interest rate number, maybe 7.5, is I want to store somewhere. And I will store somewhere is like a variable. So basically I am creating a variable named interest rate and I'm storing a value of interest rate in that variable. For example, let's say this hash is the comment. I'm doing a comment so that this line will not execute. This line is like a comment for me. And here I will write, let's say interest rate is equal to 10.5. So I created a variable. I created one variable which has a value which I have assigned is 10.5. So now, if I call this, you can see this interest rate And here the value which I have assigned is 10.5. So automatically it is coming in. You can see it here that the value 10.5 is assigned to it. Right. So this interest rate is basically my identifier, which is helping me to identify that you have created a variable which has 10.5 value is identify as interest rate. The interest rate is basically my identifier, like a name. If you want to identify me, you will say that yeah, Rahul, the Python trainer, right? So Rahul is my name. So Rahul is the identity of me. Same way, 10.5 is the value. The identity of 10.5 is interest rate. So this is known as identifier. Now there is a limitation of the identifier in the naming. My identifier should have alphabets, which can be capital or small letter. My identifier can have numbers. My identifier can have underscores. Apart from that, if you try any other character, it will not take. For example, let's say you try to create @ customer name equal to 10, or let's say John. So you see that I am getting an error. The error which we are getting is invalid syntax. I cannot have in my identifier name as @ or hash or dollars. I cannot have any other special character apart from underscore. So suppose I will make this @ to underscore and I will execute, it will work perfectly fine because underscore can be there in my identifier name, but apart from underscore, I cannot have any other special characters. I can have numbers as well, but again, number, there is one issue, like there is one limitation that I cannot have numbers at the start. 1, 2, 3, first name is equal to Rahul. You can see that I am getting an error because numbers cannot be at the start of my identifier name. Numbers can be at the end or at the center. That is perfectly fine, but it cannot be at the start of the identifier name. So I'll have to remove this. Maybe I can put 1, 2, 3, something like this. It is gonna work fine because number I can place anywhere, but it should be at the middle or at the end of the identifier name. So basically, identifier can be created. The name of a variable, the name of a function, the name of anything, which we will see in the future class also, it will be of small letters or capital letters, alphabets, or it can be of numbers, or it can be underscore. And numbers can be at the center or at the end. Underscore can be anywhere. I cannot have any special characters in my identifier name. Python programming is a case sensitive programming language. For example, I am creating trust is equal to Rahul, and CUST with capital letter is equal to, let's say, Shweta. So now here you can see that trust with a small letter will have the value assigned as Rahul, and CUST, which is caps with a capital letter, has the value called Shweta. So basically, it is a case sensitive programming language. If you are passing anything as a caps, so it will be caps only. And it will, if you are writing it in a small, it will not give me the same value because it is case sensitive. Right? So that is about the identifier. Now in Python, there are various different data types we have. Now, what are data types? For example, customer name. I want to store the customer name. My customer name will be alphabet, right? Rahul, John, Shweta, Lalit, these are like alphabets. So my customer name will be alphabets. And that type of data type is nothing but string data type. Right? It's a string data type. Now, let me see that. Let me see. I created this customer name already. I created this cust, which is Rahul. If I check the type of cust, you can see that it is str, which is a string data type. So the very first data type which we have in Python is string. So whatever data which you are passing in a string format, and that should be in the course. So if you see here, I put Rahul in the course, so it should always be in the course. For example, customer name is equal to, if I am passing Rohan and I am not passing in a course, it will gonna give me an error, because it is thinking that Rohan is also a variable. Rohan is also an identifier, but Rohan is actually a value, it's not an identifier. I have to assign Rohan in customer name, so I have to pass in a course. I can pass in a double course also, no issues. You can very well pass in a double course also, right? So you can see that in customer name, you can see the value is assigned as now Rohan. Sorry, if I check the type, it is my string. So whatever categorical data, suppose I am passing 1, 2, 3 in the double quotes, so it will consider as string only. It is string only. My customer name, the value assigned is 1, 2, 3, because as we pass in those quotes, that's why this customer name is considered as a string. That is why the data type which we are getting is string. So whatever value you are passing in a single quotes or double quotes, it will be nothing but my string data type. That is the one of the first data types which we have. Then the next year, now you must be thinking, oh, how am I executing this code? So you can go to the help and you can go to the keyboard shortcuts. When you click on the keyboard shortcuts, you will get all the options how to execute the code, right? So to execute the code, there is a command called control enter. I just have to go to the cell. I'm going to this cell number 23, and I will execute this by pressing control enter. So once I am pressing control enter, it is executed. If I want to generate more lines, as of now you see here there are only 2 lines available. I want to create more lines, I can press escape button and press B for Bombay multiple times, so multiple lines will be generated. So I can very well generate the line. I can delete the line as well. I'll press escape and press D for Delhi 2 times. DD, if you press it, you'll see that the lines are getting deleted, right? So that is how we can, again, as I mentioned, you can get that details in this keyboard shortcut. You can see, insert a cell below B. I want to press B. Insert or delete the cell, you will find somewhere here also. Delete the cell, D, D, 2 times D. Right? Control enter for execution. So control enter, select, run selected cell. So that is how you can see all these commands, how to execute this particular programs. Now the first data type which we discussed is a string data type, which consists of customer name, product name, whatever we want to store, you can save it. Second data type is integer data type. So integer is nothing but without decimal numbers. For example, let's say I want to purchase pens from the store. So pens, I can go to the store and I can say I want to purchase 5 pens, 10 pens, 15 pens, like that. I cannot say I want 10.5 pens, because pen will be a whole number. It cannot be a decimal. So I will store, let's say, pens, or let's say I want quantity. Quantity is equal to 10. So I have passed the value 10, which is I'm assigning in the variable quantity. This quantity is nothing but my identifier. I'll check the type of quantity. You can see that it is an integer. Integer is nothing but when we have a value without a decimal place. Let's say I want to store the value with decimal place, then in that case I will have to just write let's say sales. I'll write 150.6 dollars, right? 150.6. Now this 150.6 consists of a decimal place. It has a decimal. So if I check the type of the sales, you can see that it is a float. So float is nothing but my decimal data type. So basically we have string, we have integer, and we have float. String is like when I have a category, when I want to store state, customer name, product name, category, region, all those things you can do that. But for quantity, we can use, let's say I want to store the non-decimal number, I can store that in integer format. It automatically takes that. And sales, I have the decimal, so it is 150.6, so it is automatically taking that and making float the data type. It is making the float as a data type. These are like three data types we have. And one more data type which we have is Boolean data type. Boolean is nothing but true or false. Is my sales greater than $100? My sales value is already there. It is 150.6. Is that greater than 100? The answer is true. Yes, it is. So when I will press Control Enter, it will give me the answer as true. If I save this value in A, so I have created a variable A. Inside that variable, I am actually saving the output of sales greater than 100. Now sales greater than 100 is giving me true. So output of this particular line, output of this particular line is true. So I'm storing true in A. So true is a Boolean, true or false. Either the answer is true or false, right? True values. So when I check the type of A, you can see that it is a Boolean data type. So Python is automatically understanding it, that how the data, which type of data we are storing. According to that, Python automatically decides which type of data type is the best data type for that data. That is why Python is also known as dynamically typed programming language. It is automatically understanding, dynamically understanding the type of the data. That is why it is known as dynamically typed programming language. Right? So these are in your day-to-day work also, these are the variables which you will see, because you must be dealing with the strings, you must be dealing with the floats, you must be dealing with the integers, you may be dealing with the Boolean as well, but these are the main four different types of data types which we have. Right. Now here we saw that yes, we are storing one value. But can I store multiple values? For example, I want to store all the values of my customers. I want to save all the ages of my customer. So will I able to solve that? Will I able to save that? So answer is yes, we can able to save that. So for that, the concept of Python collection data types comes into picture. Python collection data type is nothing but, let me write that. So in Python collection data types, we have lists, we have tuples, we have dictionaries, and we have sets. These are my Python collection data types. Now, what does that mean? When I want to store multiple values, when I want to store multiple values in an object in Python, for example, I want to create a variable, and in that variable, I want to store multiple values. So, in that case, these types of data types come into picture. Let's try to see that how it actually works, so that we'll have a better understanding. Let's say I want to store all of your ages, right? What I want is I want to put all of your ages. There are 230 attendees here, but let's say I want to put 5 different ages. So how will I do that? To create a list, we require this square bracket. This square bracket is helping me to understand that whatever you are creating is a list. So to create a list, we require a square bracket. I'll pass the numbers. I'm just passing some random numbers, and you can see that the value is created. There is a identifier called ages. Ages consists of the list. You can see here. So now here I have all the values which we have passed in the list while creating. That is what we are able to see here directly. You can compare the values. You can see that it is there. Now, when I want to store multiple values, then list comes into picture, tuples comes into picture. But let's talk about list more in detail. Let's say I want to fetch out this number. I want to fetch out this number, which is 11. Right, from the list, I want to fetch out 11. Now, how will I do that? How will I able to fetch that? So there is a concept of indexation. There is a concept of indexing. That concept we will use for this particular thing. Right? We have to apply index. Now, what does that index mean? Index means that the position of the value in the list. Now 11 is there, right? I want to fetch out this 11. So you can see that we have, if I count at what number the 11 is, this is my first value. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. At the seventh position, 11 is present. The first occurrence of 11. 11 is present here also. But this first 11 is present at the seventh position. So if I take a square bracket and pass 7, because it's at the seventh position, right? So if I take a square bracket and pass 7 and run this command, let's see what comes in. I am expecting 11, but I am getting 21. 21 is the next value. Apart from that, there are no other 21s there. So 21 is the next value. So basically, when we are passing 7, it is giving me 21. Why? If I am passing 6, then what will happen? Now it is giving me 11. So what does that mean? It means that indexation in Python starts with 0. So basically, the first value which I have is 0, second value which I have is 1, third value which I have is 2, fourth value which I have is 3, fifth value which I have is 4, sixth value which I have is 5, and seventh value which I have is 6. So you can see that ages 6 will give me the 11. So basically, indexation in Python starts with 0. The position of the value is starting with 0. So for example, let's say if I will write ages 11. So I'll count that. 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. 22 should come. Let's see that. 22 it is coming. If I'll make it 12, 11 should come. So if I make it 12, 11 is coming. So from here, I can clearly say that the indexation in Python starts with 0. Now there is a concept of reverse indexation as well. Now what is reverse indexation? From the back side, from this side. From the back side, the indexation starts with minus 1. So when I will write ages minus 1, you can see that the value which we are getting is 22. When we are making ages minus 2, this will give me the value as 11. Right? Minus 1, minus 2. So minus 2 is nothing but 11. So it is giving me the index from the reverse direction. So if I am getting the index from the reverse direction, then it is minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, and so on. From the start, it is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. Okay. Now, if I take the ages and write 4 colon 7, if I am writing ages 4:7, now what will happen? Now it will give me the number from fourth index to seventh index. This is index number 0, index number 1, index number 2, index number 3, index number 4, index number 5, index number 6, index number 7. So basically from index number 4 till index number 7 should come, because we are adding 4:7. So when we are adding 4:7, it will give me from index number 4 till 7. Let's see whether that is how it is behaving or there is something there. Let's see that. When I press Control Enter, you can see that it is not giving 21. It is giving the value 32, 22 and 11. It is not giving 21. Now what does that mean? It means that when we are adding 4:7, then seventh value will not participate. Only 7-1, n-1. Suppose I'm writing 4:n. N means any number. So n-1 will participate. For example, let's say I'll write 2:4. Now it is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 will not participate. So only this 2 will participate. 2 and 3 will participate. What is 2 and 3 index? 2 and 3 index is nothing but 23 and 22. So it will give me 23 and 22. Okay. So that is how you will do the slicing of a list. This is called slicing. I can do a slicing of a list. Now, if I am writing ages 11:, now what will happen? I'm not sure if you guys are able to ping the answer or not. You have permission or not. But if you have, then you can try to ping and let me know that what will be the answer for this. 11:. What will be the output? Any guesses? If you can use chat window, then we will use that and answer. Do you have permissions to chat? Okay, so I'm assuming that there is no permission to chat. So answer will be 11:. So I'm giving the start point. 11 is my starting point. So 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So it will start from 11. And did I give any end point? I did not give any end point. As I did not give any point, it will go till the end. So it will print 22, 11 and 22. It will give me all the values. So when I execute this, it should give me 22, 11, 22. Let's see that. You can see that the value which we are getting is 22, 11 and 22. Right. So that is how the slicing is happening. Now, I can do the slicing from the reverse also. We know that there is a reverse indexation from -1, -2, -3, -4, -5 and so on. So if I will write ages -1:-4, what will be the output? here is my edges, minus 1 colon minus 4. So now here it is minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4. We know that minus 4 will not participate. So it should give me minus 1, minus 2, minus 3. That is 22, 11, 22. So it should give me 22, 11, 22 when we do the reverse indexing. Let's see whether it is working the same way or not. Let's execute and check that. It is giving me an empty list. It is giving me an empty list. That means nothing is coming. Now question arises, why? It is because of the direction. Here I am passing 2 colon 4. 2 colon 4 is, can I say it is from left to right? 11 colon. 11 colon is again from left to right. So basically when we are slicing from left to right, it is working fine. But when we are slicing from left, right to left, because here minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4. I am going from right to left. So when I am going from right to left, Python does not understand that. Python understands from left to right. If you are going from right to left, then you have to tell Python that I want to go from right to left. How can we do that? We have to pass after this colon minus 1 again. Minus 1 is the direction. By default it takes plus 1, which is from left to right. But when we want to go from right to left, then we have to say that minus 1, which is from right to left. Now it will give me 22, 11, 22. Let's check that. You can see now it is coming in. So it is the story of the direction. If you are not passing minus 1, then by default it is from left to right. If you are slicing from left to right, then it will slice. But if you are slicing from right to left and you are passing plus 1 as the direction, then it will give me an empty list, right? So this empty list can be taken care by passing minus 1 as the direction, so that Python will understand that we have to move from right to left rather than left to right, right? So that is how this particular slicing works. In the list I can update the values as well. For example, let's say by mistake I put it 11 here. I want to update that 11 to 31. So what is the index of 11? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So edges of 6 will give me 11. And what I want is I want to update this to 31. Done. If I check the edges, you can see that the value earlier was 11. Now it is 31. It is updated to 31. That is how you will be able to do the updation of the values in the list. Okay. Now there are a lot many functions associated with the list, which you will see. For example, I have this ages, right? Ages dot. When I press ages dot, after that, if I press the tab command, the tab button, when I press on the tab button, it will give me all the functions associated with the list. It will show me all the functions associated with the list. The very first function is append. Append is helping me to append the value. I already have the list, which consists of 32 till 22. I want to append a new value in the same list at the last. So after 22, let's say I want 34, let's say. So I will append. And then I will write 34. And execute this. Now if I check this ages, you can see that the 34 is added at the last. So append will add the value at the last. You can see that I appended the value 34 at the last. If I want to append multiple values, then let's see how it is working, when it is working. Basically, what I want is ages.append. Let me append multiple values, 45, 43, 42, 46, control enter. You can see that we are getting an error. Append takes only one argument for given. So basically, append takes one argument, that is 34, 42, and so on. But it was given 4.
Rahul?
Yeah.
So I make you as an admin and organizer. So now you can see the chat box in your screen.
Yeah,
the question chat is active for you.
All right.
Can you see that?
Yeah, I can see that.
Okay.
Okay. Let me go through some questions. I see. For I in range, you require colon also. Okay. You did not print colon. We'll come to that. Don't do it now. There is a syntax which you have to pass. How to start Jupyter Notebook? You can go to the Windows and look for JUPY and it will come up. You can click on that. Wait. There are a lot of packages which we have in Python which helps me to do artificial intelligence. For example, self-driving car. It's the latest example that people are using. So it processes a lot of images and help me to create the solution. Can you explain -1:-4:-? Yeah, I'll do that. So here there is a concept of reverse indexation, right? So reverse indexation is basically nothing but from the back side. So from the back side means from here. So this is -1, -2, -3, -4, -5, and so on. So -1 till I want to go till -4. But what is the direction? The direction is from right to left. Here we saw 2:4 and so on. That is from left to right. Reverse indexation starts with -1, not 0. So -1:-4, you are saying, but direction is from right to left. So you have to mention Python that I want to go from right to left. By default, it takes left to right. So you have to write -1 so that it will go from right to left. Okay. So that is why I am passing here that I want to go from -1 to -4 and the direction is reverse. I hope this is clear to all of you. Yes, indentation is very, very important. I'll come to that, guys. What is round bracket? What is square bracket? We just started, right? So kindly give me some time. Black screen comes in. Black screen will come. Don't close that black screen. But check your website also, web page also. In the web page, Jupyter will be open. If you close this black screen, then Jupyter will not work. It's a kernel, right? Don't close this. Keyboard shortcuts, you can go to help and you can check for keyboard shortcuts out here. Here you will find the keyboard shortcuts. To execute, it is control enter to create new line. press B for Bombay. How to install Python? You can go to Anaconda website, which is here. You can see Anaconda.com and individual edition, and go to here. -1:-4, -4:-1. The output will be different. Check this. I have ages. Okay. And you write -1:-4:-1 because I want to give the direction also. And you are saying that why not we can go for -4:-1. See that? Is the output same? -1 will not participate. Here it -1 is participating. So answer will be different. Okay. It will run on i3 machine, that is fine. Direction is required to mention in reverse and yes. When you are doing reverse indexation, then direction is required. Else by default it takes 1. How to download Jupyter? I already mentioned. Go to this anaconda.com and you can download from there. To download this Python, automatically Jupyter, Anaconda, everything will get downloaded. How to open that? Go to Windows and write JUP. Automatically it will come. Press Enter, it will open. It will open this black window. At the same time, it will open up the Jupyter in the browser as well. All right, so let's proceed. All right. To get the functions here, we have ages dot and press tab button. Once you press tab button, then I will get all the functions. Okay. So we already saw append. Append basically appending the value at the end. The second command is clear. It will clear all the list. So when I execute this, you can see that when I check my list again, my list will not have any value. Everything is cleared. Okay. So when we are creating a list, then we require a square bracket. So when you want to create a list, square bracket is required. But when you want to call any function, that function can be called using normal bracket. So I'm calling ages again. I'm creating a list. So I created the list using the square bracket. But when I want to run any function of the list, ages dot like copy, I will have to pass the normal bracket. And I'm taking a copy of this ages one. Now you can see that we have ages one, which consists of the copy of it, which is exactly same as the ages. So like that, there are a lot many commands. Ages dot tab. Then we have count. I want to count how many 11s are there. So it will give me 2 because there are 2 11s are there. 11, 11, 11 and 11. 2 11s are there. So it will count the value. Ages dot tab. Then we have extend. Extend is helping me to add multiple values. Append can take only one value at a time. Append cannot take multiple values at a time. If you try to go with append, we saw that, I think. So it is showing me an error. So So if I want to vend multiple values, then the command is extend. But here you have to pass in a square bracket. It's like a list. You have to pass as a list. 34, 56, 76, 78, 89. Control enter. You can see that ages are there and it consists of the new values as well. So basically, I am appending a list with a list, something like that. You can say that. So suppose I have a list, I have another list, I want to append together. I can use this extend command also. List one dot extend list two. That type of thing can be done, right? Now, let's see some more commands. What all we have? So ages dot tab. Index. I want to find the index of 89, the value which I have, right? 89 at the last. So the, I want to find the index of 89. You can see that the index of 89 is 18. You can count that 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18. So the index of 89 is 18. If suppose I am finding the index of 11, it will give me the index of 11 of the first value, the first 11 occurrence. Suppose I want to know the index of 11, then it will give me the first occurrence index. It will not give me the second occurrence index. It will give me 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, sixth position. Ages dot tab, then we have insert. Now I want to insert a record. I want to insert a record at a particular position. For example, I want to insert a record between 22 and 11. I want to insert, let's say, 5 between 22 and 11. I want to insert 5. What is the index of 22? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So basically, I want to insert a record at the 6th position. So that 11 will shift to 7. 5 will insert between 22 and 11. So at the 6th position, I want to insert 5. So now you can see that ages. You can see 5 is inserted between 22 and 11. That is how it works. Right? So at any particular position, if you want to insert, you can very well insert that with this insert. Index will not work like this. Like index of 11 I want, right? So if I want 11 comma minus 1, it will give me an error. It will not work like that. Pop. Pop removes the values from the last. Right? Pop removes the value from the last. If I will write ages dot pop 10, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. It removes the value at the 10th position. So if you see ages, you see that 89 is no longer there and 33 is also no longer there. So pop is helping me to delete the value. Now ages dot tab remove. I want to remove, let's say, 33. It will remove the first occurrence of 33. When you go to ages, you can see that the first occurrence of 33 was here, is no longer here. It removed it. Then we have ages dot reverse. It will reverse the list. pages, you can see it just reversed. Okay. Pop will remove pop text index. It will remove the index, 11th index value, not 11th. Pop will take the index. Here I passed pop 10, it removed 33. 10th index value. Okay. I can sort the values in the list also, ages dot sort. Now when you see that ages, you can see that it is ascending order. The values are from smaller to bigger. I want to make it descending order. So ages dot sort again, and I'll make reverse is equal to true. So when I will do reverse equal to true, then what will happen? Ages will give me the reverse order. Descending order basically. So these are some of the properties, some of the functions in the list. List pop work from left to right, not right to left. Now, if I want to sum up the values, I want to sum up all the ages. You can very well sum up the ages. You can see here the sum is coming in. If I want to find the minimum value of the ages, I'll get the minimum value as well. Maximum value of ages, that is 78. Right, so I have this ages. Pop is nothing but removing. Let's say I want to remove 5. So what is the index of 5? 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. So I want to pop 16th index value. So it will remove 5. Ages.sort will sort the data. I have different ages. I am sorting from bigger to smaller or smaller to bigger. Pop requires index, remove requires number. I want to remove 22, or let's say I want to remove 78. So dot remove 78. Now here indexation is not required. Right? So ages, you can see 78 is no longer there. Pop requires index number and this thing, what do you say? Remove requires the value. Age dot sort reverse equal to do will reverse my data. Right. Average function directly, it's not there. We have to call the package for that. So we have the ages out here. Now my list can have different types of data types as well. For example, I'm creating a new list. List 1 is equal to 10, 10.5, Rahul, and I am passing true. So 10 is integer, 10.5 is a float, Rahul is a string, true is a boolean. So when I see list one of zero, you see 10 coming in. When I check the type of this, it is giving me an integer. When I say 10.5 index number 1, it's a float. 2 is Rahul, so it's a string, and 3 is true, it's a boolean. So Python stores the value of its own original data type in the list. So if I'm passing 10, it's an integer, 10.5, it's a float. Rahul is a string, true is a boolean. Ages dot sort reverse equal to true will reverse the sorting. For example, I have ages. As of now, what it is? Descending order. Ages dot sort, if I will do, what will happen? Ages, you can see now the value coming is ascending. 11 till 76. 11 is smaller, 76 is bigger. I want to sort descending. 76 first, 11 at the last. So dot sort reverse equal to true. Then it will make 76 first. Okay. Those guys who are facing issue in Python, kindly ignore that. Concentrate on my screen. You will get the recording. So you can work on that later on. Because here I cannot solve the issues of Python as of now, because there are 230 plus attendees. If all of you guys will say that Python is not getting installed commercially, we cannot solve at this point in time. It will be time consuming process. So please concentrate on my screen. Download your Python once this session will get over. Regarding all these quotes which we are discussing, I will share all the quotes with you guys. So don't worry about it. And I will highly encourage, don't do hands-on as of now. Just concentrate what we are discussing here. And later on, we can talk about that. Okay. Now, the second data type which we have is tuples. We already discussed about lists. Now, there is a concept of tuples. If I want to create a tuple, let's say ages. To create a tuple, we have to pass the normal bracket. And then I'll pass some numbers. Now, ages, you can see the type of this. It's a tuple. Now, what is tuple? What is the meaning of tuple? Like, what if list is doing the same thing, then why tuple? We saw that in the list, we are able to change the value. If I want to change any particular value, for example, let's say here, this 32 is there, I want to update to 34. We can do that by passing the index number, and we can like 0, 1, 2, 3. So index number 3, I want to make it 100, let's say. But here it is tuple. I already gave the name as, let me rename this. I'll make this as, let me do one thing. This is my ages underscore tuple. I'll execute this, and I have ages underscore list. So now if I have ages underscore tuple, if I try to update, let's say, 0th position, that is 32, with 100, and I'll do the same thing with the list also, ages underscore list. You can see that in ages underscore list, the value got updated to 100. However, when we are trying to do it in tuple, it will give me an error. Okay. That means tuple, I cannot update the values. In list, I can update the values. That means tuple is immutable, and list is mutable. I can change the values in the list. That is the difference. So for example, let's say I want to create a list which does not have, like, I don't want any changes. For example, state. So in the state, I want to update the value. I know that states will never change. State values will never change. So I may prefer to go with tuple as the state, right? But I know if there are some values which are going to change, for example, names. Maybe after marriage, we are changing the name. So I know that the values will change. So if the values will change, that means I can go with the list. I don't require tuple there because tuple, I cannot change the value, right? It's immutable. So as I cannot change the value in the tuple, the functions which are associated with the tuple are very less. We have only two functions. One is count. I want to count, let's say 44. I have two count of 44. Second is ages tuple dot index. I want to find the index of 100. That is, sorry, index of 0, the value. Tuple. Okay, my bad. So tuple. I want to find the index of 32. So dot index of 32. You can see that it is 0. Tuple we use, as I mentioned, when I don't want to corrupt my data. I know that I cannot make changes in the tuple, so I'll go with the tuple where I don't want to make any changes. Right? Index of 55, yeah, 55 is present in the tuple. If 55 is present, then yes, it will give me index number 2. At index number 2, 55 is present. Control enter. Yeah. Okay. So let me quickly go through that what we have discussed till now. So ages dot tab or ages dot ages underscore list. Ages underscore list dot tab. We spoke about, I'll now take 15 minutes to what we have discussed till now, and then we'll see whether we can proceed or not. The first thing we discussed is Python. It's a open source programming language, free of cost, obviously. That is why it is very much in demand. Secondly, I can do a lot of things using Python. I can do artificial intelligence. I can do machine learning. I can do automation. I can do data analytics. I can do create a website using Python. I can create an application using Python. I can create database applications using Python. I can do automations using Python. I can do a lot of things. That's why it is very much in demand. Someone asked that what is the limitation of Python and what programming language we can go for. There is only one limitation in Python. That is, I cannot use to create a mobile application using Python. I cannot use mobile application. I cannot create mobile application. That is one thing which we cannot do as of now. But apart from that, everything is doable in Python. Well, I am using Jupyter Notebook because Jupyter Notebook is very much in demand. People are using it. We can go with PyCharm also. No issues with that. But my experience is more on Jupyter and Spyder because majority of the clients are using that. So that's why I'm using that, this particular GUI. But you can use PyCharm, so there is no issues with that. After that, we spoke about different types of data types. The different types of data types which we have are list. We first spoke about different types of data types with integer. Then we have Boolean. Integer is nothing but the numbers 10, 20, 30, 40. Those are my integer data types. Then we spoke about string, which is a name, customer name, product name, all those things I want to store. So that will be my string data type. Then we have Boolean data type true false. So Boolean data type will give me the value like true and false. And then float. Float is basically nothing but decimal, 10.5, 5.5, and so on. If you want to check which type of what is my data type, let's say a equal to 10. So it's an integer. We can check that through type of a, which is integer, int. Right? Type command is used. Now, apart from that, these data types, which are like highly used, obviously, in your day-to-day work, you must have using this type of data type. Apart from that, we have lists, tuples, dictionaries, and sets. We spoke about lists and tuples. When we want to store multiple values, because as of now here in the variables, I can store one value. But if I want to store multiple values, then we can very well use lists, tuples, dictionaries, and sets. We already spoke about lists. There are various functions we have spoke about with the list. So here are the functions we have. One is append. So when I have a list, I want to add some more values in that list, then we can use append. Then we have a clear command which helps me to clear the values from the list. Then we have copy command. We can copy the list and save it in different list altogether. We can count the value in the list. Then we can extend the value. That means if I want to add some more values, multiple values in the list, then I can do it extend, because in append I can add only one value at a time. Then we have index. If I want to find the index of any particular number, we can find that. Insert at a particular location, I want to store the value, then I can use insert. Let's say at the fifth position, index position, I want to store some value. So I can use the index. I can use the insert. Then pop is helping me to remove the value by passing the index of that value. And if I'm not passing anything in the pop, then by default it will remove the value from the last of the list. Remove requires the value itself. I want to remove the value, then I will pass that value, it will remove from the list. Reverse is just going to reverse the list. That is not nothing but it's not like ascending or descending, it is just reverse. So it's not sorting, it's reversing only. Sort is going to sort the value from ascending order by default. If I want to do descending order, we will write reverse equal to true. When we will do reverse equal to true, then it will do the descending sort. That is what we discussed in the list. We can apply some and all those other functions as well. Then we have tuples. So in tuple, as I know that we cannot make changes in the tuple, so only limited functions are there. That is count and index. Count will give me count of any particular number which you are passing, and index will give me the index of that particular number which you are passing. Some and other things can also be done in this particular tuple also. If I want to convert a list to tuple or tuple to list, that can very well possible. So let's say I have ages.list. I want to convert it to tuple, just pass tuple with a bracket. It will convert the value to a tuple. Meanwhile, if I'll make it a is equal to, you can see that a is a tuple. And when I check the type of it, it should be tuple. You can see it is tuple. Same way I have ages list. I want to convert, ages tuple. I want to convert to the list. That is also pretty much possible by passing the list and the bracket. And you can see that now it is a list. I'll save it in A. When I check the type of A, you can see that it is a list. Okay. So that is what we have covered till now. Are you a CA? I am not CA. I was engineer. I did my engineering from NIT Surat. After that, I joined Accenture, then worked for Capgemini, then Tech Mahindra, then Deloitte. Then I worked for a company called Rawmind, the startup, and now I have my own company. Okay. That is my introduction. Can string be converted into list? String, it should have different values, right? I can convert it. For example, let's say I want to put all of your names. So let's say names is equal to, I can pass the values. Let's say Rahul, Rohan, Shweta, and so on. So now here I have the names, which is nothing but a list. We can check the type also. So my type is the list. Okay. As I mentioned, tuple can be used when I know that my values cannot change. For example, state name, I know that state name will not change ever. Or I don't want my data to be corrupt. I don't want anyone can update the value. So I may go with a tuple. Right? And when I know that the values will change, in that case, I'll go with the list. That is the use case. Okay. No. Here, when I'm writing A equal to list, A equal to tuple, so it is overriding it. There are no A. There are no two different A's. When I'm writing A equal to tuple age list, it is creating a tuple. But when we are writing this, so it is overriding the previous command. So the previous value will no longer be there. I cannot have same name values in two different. Same name values is not possible, basically. Python can be used in professional work. Like I can do a lot of coding, right? As I mentioned that I'll show you. I created one such small code. Suppose I want to do some predictions, right? So let me show you that. You can see that I have created this small HR analytics code in Python, right? So here, what it is doing is, it is actually predicting the salary of an employee based on his experience. So suppose if I'll change the experience, you can see that the salary is opportunity. So this is a very small app which we have created, right? Similarly, we can do a lot more things. I think one more app I can show if it is enabled. This is disabled as of now, but basically it helps me to do a lot of predictions, right? So this is a data science point of view, but yeah, a lot of things can be done. As I mentioned, a lot of automations, a lot of visualizations we can create, which you will see in the future classes as well. We can take the Excel data, I can put that in Python. All those things can be done. Okay. If I have databases, then in databases also I can connect to Python. And I can use that data for analysis. All these things, everything is possible in Python. That is why Python is a highly demanding job. Like highly demanding programming language, and people are using it in all the different jobs. Okay. Till this point, any questions you have? Because I'm not going to start a new topic because that will take time to complete. So if you have any questions, anything you can ask. Tomorrow we'll talk about dictionary and sets. But apart from that, if you have any questions, kindly ask that. I'll share one of my links of GitHub repository where you will have all the codes available. Excellent way of teaching. Thank you, Pradeep. What is the scope of finance professional data analysis? See, any data analysis work can be done using Python, right? So scope is definitely a huge. There is no doubt about that. My experience is mostly in the finance. Majority of my clients are from finance. So the entire thing which I have done in Python through my finance. So there are a lot many scope. There is like humongous scope. So there is no end to it. This is not a rigid language than Python. This is not a rigid language that C++. Yes, problem. And this is the main thing which Python has. So I'll talk about the history of Python and you will understand it. Give me a minute. I'll just see a lot of questions coming in. We'll take some example on data analytics. We'll come to that. This app can be hosted in web pages. Very well, it can be hosted. Absolutely. Some of the use case of Python, for example, let's say insurance, right? If I talk about insurance, so I want to know whether the transaction which are happening or someone claiming for the insurance are fraudulent or not. Python is better than compared to R programming, because Python we can do artificial intelligence, which we cannot do in R. We can connect Python and XBase. We'll see that in one of the sessions. So let me come to the history of Python. So basically, Python is a language which is actually taking properties from various different programming languages. Python is like, there are various versions of Python, Python 1, Python 2, Python 3. So there is no guarantee that Python 1 is, when I'm creating a code on Python 2, it will work in Python 3, not really possible. Like, there are chances that Python 2 code will not work in Python 3, right? Because of the flexibility which it has. So it takes all the properties from different programming language. So it takes some property from C programming, takes some properties from C++, takes some properties from Java programming. So it took various properties from various different programming language. So that is why it is more flexible, right? So every new version will come in, there are chances that the code which we have created in the older version will not work in a new version. So you have to recode it, and they give you enough time that my support for the previous version will be stopped after 10 years. You can do, or after 5 years, you can recreate our code. But Python does not want to restrict ourselves. That's why they come up with this approach, that they are using all the properties from different programming languages and making it more better. Five to 6 months are easily good to spend time with Python. Right, so that it will be more comfortable. So here I told you that I'll give this link to you guys. Whatever we are learning, entire course are present here, right? So this is for your reference. I'll share this link now so that you can do use this and practice on it. Right, so this can be handy for you. Python does not require internet even now. Not required. You can use Anaconda, that is the best option. All right, so this is what I think we can have. Any questions, please let me know. Today is the first session, so I don't want to be on rush. Any questions? Installation issues, you can very well try from your side and it will be solved. People without any background programming, what we are doing is from the start only. So whatever we have discussed today, was that understandable, all of you guys? Whatever we have discussed, are you able to understand? So that is the start. If you are able to understanding it, I think you should able to learn Python easily, right? So it's a very, very basic things we are starting. So from the very basic we are starting, so you don't have to worry about that. So by end of this 5-day program, you should be more confident on this program. You don't have to create your GitHub ID. You can directly use this link. It is basic only, Abhishek. We discussed from the basic only. At the end of the program, mostly you should able to import Excel. You can create some charts using Python. All those things can be done, right? By end of this program, or you can do some automation. For example, you want to do some mathematical calculations on your day-to-day work. So you will able to do that by creating the functions, right? That is also possible. GitHub is a version control tool. So that's another separate topic. We can find the trend using Python. Yes, absolutely. Why not? All right, so maybe I can create a WhatsApp group. I'll check with the team and I'll share the link. You can join that.
I'm going to create a WhatsApp group by today.
Okay.
So I'll add you also in that group.
Python can be substituted for Excel, yes, absolutely. If you have good understanding of programming, then you can very well use that. Can we calculate taxes using Python? Yeah, absolutely. You can create. You should have your mathematics, right? You should have your calculations. You can use that. One of the books I have for Python, I'll share that with you. I'll share everything in the WhatsApp. What will be the database for Python? Python is a programming language. It's not a database. It can take data from databases. Python runs on RAM. For CA, I was searching. So basically, you can use Python for your day-to-day calculation. You must be doing a lot of calculations from your side, right? So you can very well use Python. You must be creating some charts also. So Python can be used for that. Packages we will discuss in the last sessions. All right. So this is what I have. We'll see you again tomorrow. Any questions? We can post later on. You are not audible. Shweta.
Now, is it fine?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, what we understood from you today is some basic features, what we can do with Python, data type of Python, and collection of data. And what is identifier, how to create this, indexation, reverse indexation, and many more. It is a bit technical for us, but you have explained very well and in detail. So I'm sure participant must have benefited. So thank you so much for a very knowledgeable session. And friends, I understand since there is an online training, so some may have a feeling like it was too fast and the session is, but in any ways, our session is going to record it for all the day. And we would be able to provide all the recording after the completion of all the sessions. So please don't ask on that daily basis. It is not possible. We will send you all the sessions recording after completion of all the sessions. Maybe after 1 week of completion of the this workshop. So if anyone has left out anything, so you can revise the recording. So that's it for today. We'll meet again for tomorrow. So if no questions and nothing is there, we can close it for today. Right, Rahul?
Yeah, so there are many students are there, many participants are there. So I may not be able to answer all of you guys. So kindly bear with me. I will try to answer as much as possible. If not, then we will be connected on the WhatsApp group, so we can chat over there also.
Yeah, and I'm going to create a WhatsApp group by today, tonight itself. So I will add you also. So if anyone wants to raise their queries, they can raise it. But we will keep it open, this group, for a limited period. Otherwise, unnecessary chat will start, something like that. So I'm not going to open this WhatsApp group open all the time. I'm clearly telling you. So we can decide the time and we can open it for some period of time. So people can raise their query. So is it fine?
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. So we can close it for today. So thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. We'll meet again tomorrow.
All right. Thanks, guys. Take care.
Thank you.